You are listening to Rockin the Cast, show number one, wow, with your host Jimmy and B.T.
Yeah, what's up, fishing land? This is your host, Jimmy. God bless you. I'm Hank Parker. Hey, what are you doing here, man? What's going on out there, everybody? Just chilling. And with always, I've got my co-host, BT. BT, what's up, man?
Hello, fishing world. I would say that I'm across the proverbial desk, but let's see, what's our distance, Georgia to Arkansas?
13 hours by Highway 40.
So 13 hours across the proverbial podcast desk.
Yes. Yes. Per the interwebs crow flying, we are 13 hours, but we are merely seconds away with no delay on the interwebs.
Oh, that was nice. That was nice. I can dig that.
I'm rhyming, dude. Rhyming. Okay. This week's show is brought to you by Custom Bait Company. Custom Bait Company out of Missouri. For all your jigging needs, Custom Bait Company, can you jig it?
That was outstanding. That was outstanding. This is show number one of Rockin the Cast. So it should be an interesting journey. Is that what we're going to call it?
Yeah, let's we could say journey. I like the term hot mess. You know, yeah. Kind of like when you backlash. We don't like to call it a backlash or a bird's nest. It's more of a professional overrun.
Is that what we'll call it?
Yes, we are so on a professional overrun.
So Rockin the Cast, professional overrun. show number one
instead of a backlash,
right okay, instead of right. A backlash, okay,
or just say hot mess, hot, you know, mess. Over here in the South I think they say that a lot. But you're a Yank and I'm from California,
right?
So
I don't think that really, yeah,
I don't think that counts for us.
That doesn't fit in
anything.
All right. So Rockin the Cast, what's it about, Jimmy?
Rockin the Cast is not your grandfather's fishing show.
Oh, mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not going to be kissing fish and giggling and saying, hey, wow, look at that 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 pounder.
So, you know, no babe Winkleman.
Welcome to the Winkleman's kitchen. This is how you cook a the walleye. None of that.
Jimmy Houston. I mean, much respect to both of them, right?
Oh, absolutely, because they're founders of the sport and everything, you know? I mean, and especially TV and radio fishing programs, but we're kind of more of an attitude, you know, of attitude, you know? Kind of... not your grandpa's everyday.
Right. Right.
Exactly. That one. not your normal fishing podcast. We're going to try to keep things kind of current, kind of edgy. And, you know, if we have a topic, good, bad, or indifferent, we're going to discuss on it and see what we can come to, and even take, you know, with all the interwebs places that we are at, and we'll discuss those later and drop a plug on those. But, you know, you can send us questions, topics, you know, we're going to be really open to hearing what the listeners want to hear, and or if they want to discuss something or have a question, and you know, we'll have some games and some other stuff, so it's gonna be a good show, man. I really think this will be different, and you know, we'll just do it. We'll just do it our way, kind of, you know, old school punker DIY style.
And we are available via email at rockinthecast@gmail.com, on Twitter at rockinthecast. Make sure you leave out the G. It is rockinthecast. So that's something to keep in mind. And it is wide open for all our listeners. We're going to be available on SoundCloud, Blog Talk Radio, iTunes, and YouTube as well. So many venues, many, many venues.
Yes.
To check us out on.
A fort venue.
Wow. All right. And today's show is sponsored by The Custom Bait Company. The Custom Bait Company wants to know, can you jig it? With over 30 years of hand-pouring jigs, the difference is in the pigs they catch. The Custom Bait Company offers shake-its, football heads, and swim jigs that are all handmade and double-painted to provide durability no matter how hard you fish them. Worried about a stout hook when throwing into grass? Well, no worries with the Custom Bait Company, as they build all their jigs with trusted Mustad hooks. Don't think they have a color combo you can use? Huh. Well, think again. The Custom Bait Company offers 46 different color combos. Ready to fish the difference? Visit CustomBaitCo.com for your difference maker today.
Yeah, thank you, Custom Bait Co. too, for
thank
hooking
you.
Us up for our first week's show. That's Shane over there, and he is good people, man. Shane and his dad. Mad shout out to those guys.
And I believe you're getting a bunch of product from them. Do you know what you have?
I've actually joined their team. And over at the Custom Bait Co., they actually have a fishing team that I am going to discuss later in our product review.
Outstanding, outstanding. Well, we do have, what do we have coming up? So we have coming up, we have a tackle review coming up, Jimmy.
Yes.
Of the Spro.
We do. The tackle review itself, I was going to talk about the Spro Fat Fly this week. The Spro Fat Fly, Bill Simitel and Spro. Bill Simitel from BBZ. I'm sure people are mostly familiar with that. He is the guy who brought the really big California swim baits to the scene. Well, he also designed this bait called the Fat Fly, P-H-A-T. By the way, if you go to Tackle Warehouse or anything like that, it's P-H-A-T.
That's very
good. He wanted to design one out of doll hair. I guess the doll hair jigs on the West Coast for a lot of years, you know, grandpas were throwing them for trout, and they'd catch bass and a lot of different species. Well, Bill brought them back for the floating fly technique, which I just tried last Sunday.
And success?
And for the first time. Yeah. When we went out to Table Rock Tailwaters, and the bass weren't biting very good at all. Water temp was 46, overcast. We just couldn't really put anything together. We might have been fishing too fast still, but we went downriver a little bit and put the kayaks in a pretty hot trout area. And I had my graph on. I've got a little Lowrance Elite 4X on the kayak, and came over a hump in the dead center of the river, and I had a huge mark right there where it dipped, and I had that fat fly on and cast back there with about a 6-foot leader and a 3/4 ounce bobber, and just sat there and kind of twitched it because it wasn't, the river wasn't flowing real well. They weren't pulling water, so it was really still, and just kind of worked it right through that hole that I'd gone over, and then my bobber goes under, set the hook, and pull it up, and it's my biggest native rainbow yet out of the White River. He measured just a little over 17.
And that's the pictures I'm looking at, right? Is that the pictures I have? We'll share those on Twitter and we'll have them up on the YouTube, but this is what I'm looking at.
Yeah, that's the picture with it hanging out of his mouth.
Right.
I wanted to make sure I got a really good close-up photo of the color of that fat fly, and it's a really good technique, especially finesse fishing, because the where the line tie is and the way that the weight is proportioned,
that top of
the jig
head
actually doesn't fall down.
Ah.
It sits horizontally.
Huh. And I see the line tie. It's up at the top. I mean, like I said, we'll post pictures of this. It looks like it's almost above the eye towards the back of the head on there.
Right. It's almost dead center towards the bigger part of the head, and it's weighted just right. So when you throw it, and especially under a bobber, it'll lay horizontal and make itself look like there's literally like a little bait fish just floating.
And what's that color? What do you remember the name of that color?
Oh, that's they're available in 5 colors, and that color there is the other type of shad. There's a ghost shad, that shad, a bluegill, a perch color, and then there's a green gizzard shad, and I believe that one's the blue. Okay. The blue gizzard shad, or a blue shad, something like that.
And is that the only one that you're carrying in your tackle right now?
No, I've also got the green gizzard shad, and those are both the ones I bought because my local tackle shop doesn't carry the 1/8 ounce. I was only able to get the 1/16 ounce. So, and like I said, had about a, now the way he hooks up his bobber too is a little different. And I'll share that. I know it kind of without video feed or anything, it's kind of rough, but I'll try to explain it. You know, on a old school bobber, you've got your top and your bottom clasp, right? They're spring loaded.
Right.
You push the top one down, the bottom one comes down. You push the bottom, the top, or the push the top without pushing on the ring.
And sometimes
and the top's exposed.
Goes through your finger because you're pushing so hard in the damn thing.
Right. You're like, why isn't it working? Right. And then then it's like through your fingernail on the other side.
Right.
But what Bill does and these are all available also on, like I said, there's no affiliation here, but I just think the man's incredible. BBZ.com has all the his YouTube videos, and he also has a YouTube channel. He goes in depth on a couple different videos about his float and fly, and that's where I learned all this from. He'll take his bobber and wrap it just push down to where the bottom's exposed.
Okay.
And just wrap around the bottom 3 times and then let it suck back into itself on the bobber.
Right.
And he won't attach the top.
So it's just dangling.
Right. So then you can tell with that bobber set up, if that jig does not hit bottom, the bobber lays on its side.
Oh, okay.
So you know your bottom or a fish has grabbed it.
Okay. Oh, I see what you're talking about.
Yeah, exactly. And then when it hits, when it gets over to the depth that you're looking for and beyond, that bobber will stand straight up.
Ah, okay. Okay.
It's really cool the way, you know, so if I've got a 5-foot leader and I throw up into 4.5 foot, it's not going to sit right. I've got to work it out a little bit further. But I know if I throw it and I'm in 8 foot and I have a 5-foot leader and for some reason that bobber's still laid over,
right?
Then I need to reel down and hit him.
Okay.
Because a fish has got it and is just staying at that same depth level. He hasn't gone up or down with it.
So what was the full rigging setup that you had throwing this?
Okay, full rigging setup. I had my 7-foot medium light rod, 7 pound FC Sunline FC Sniper fluorocarbon, and then the a 3/4 ounce bobber and a 1/16 ounce fat fly, and I was throwing a 6 foot. I had about a 6 foot leader.
And were you planning on snagging a bass, or was the trout in the game plan when throwing?
No, trout were not. I had originally gone up to the Table Rock to try to maybe catch a couple wintering spotted bass around the submerged cedar trees.
Okay.
You know, there's a, when they flooded it, there's a bunch of old cedar that's still standing. Nice. And you know, the bass usually bass and crappie will suspend around there, but with water temp at 46 degrees, it was a little hard to find them.
I'm sure.
I had one bite in 4 hours.
Right. All right. So overall, what are we saying on the Spro Fat Fly?
Two thumbs up, man.
Two thumbs up. Sure.
Two thumbs up, or the metal horns. That's two fingers up.
Oh, we might. Yeah, maybe we'll find.
We will
a
double metal logo. Horn, and that'll be four fingers up.
So, we'll do a, we'll put a post a little review on the Spro Fat Fly, and we'll have your little hook 'em horns type of deal going on there.
Yeah.
All right. let's we talked quickly about how we can be contacted. Everybody, submit your questions, whether it be social media. We're on Twitter right now. Our Facebook is lacking, so please help us out in the Facebook world. Is our Facebook Rocking the Cast? See, I don't even know.
Yeah.
I don't even know if they're... Cause
oh, you don't know the backslash?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's Rocking the Cast.
Pretty sure we're backslash Rocking the Cast without the G.
Yeah, without the G. And then Twitter, we're at Rockin' the Cast, and then email, like I said, rockinthecast@gmail.com. We want to introduce, Jimmy, we want to introduce this, Stump the Host.
Stump the Host, and the host being me.
Oh, that's you. Oh, okay. All right, that's you.
Wow. So okay. We're trying to stump me.
So we're going to try to stump you, and all okay. This is going to be covert ops, top secret. Secret squirrel, whatever you want to call it. I'll handle everything. And okay. we're going to have the listeners stump you. Now, how do you want to be stumped? What are the different categories? Does it have to stick to fishing or?
No, not at all. I'm pretty good at three things. I would say fishing,
eating.
Eating. Yes. Yes, very much.
And taking... Oh, okay. Oh, sorry.
Will you let me finish?
I thought this was an answer, you know, trying to stump me at the time. Okay, go ahead.
Will you let me finish?
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, I'm finished. Okay, so fishing, first and foremost, because we are a fishing show.
Okay, fishing.
Then music,
any genre,
music question,
any, okay,
whatsoever. And I promise, folks at home, as Mike Iaconelli would say, folks at home, I'm not gonna look at the questions.
Okay, right? I mean, I have a feeling. I have a feeling it's going to turn into a battle. So you're not going to look at any of the questions, but so fishing and music. So we're not going outside of that. Is that correct?
Fish. Yes, we can.
Can we go into?
Let's go into pop culture.
Okay, pop culture as a whole. How about that?
As a whole, movies, TV, quotes, anything like that. I'm good with it, and. And we'll give away prizes. Let's give away. If you can stump me, we will send you stuff.
Stuff. Let's see. What can we pull out of our used tackle bag? Oh, I mean, let's see. What can we pull that's new? How about, let's see.
I have got some vicious 8-pound test still in the box and a couple of jigs.
Monofluoro? What's the line? What's the vicious line? Monofluoro?
What is that? I think it's green mono.
Green mono.
But it's vicious.
Okay.
And then a couple jigs from Rockin' the or from
Rockin' the Cast.
Yeah, a couple jigs courtesy of Custom Bait Co. Can you jig it from Rockin' the Cast?
From Rockin' the Cast. All right, so we will do that. We'll open up the questions on Twitter, and we'll try and get this really going next week. So we'll see if we have our first stump the host question next week.
Yeah, and I will just say that this week I win, so I get the fishing line and the jigs, and we'll figure out something else next week.
Well, man. Okay, let's see. Stump the host. Oh, were there any other ways? Did you want to talk about your carrier pigeons or the turtles that can possibly bring the...
Yes, you can. Yeah, either by carrier pigeon or Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle.
I thought we were just talking tortoises, but you took it to a whole nother.
No, I will drop the Ninja Turtles too. You know, if Leonardo knocks on the door and he's like, "Hey, bro, who wrote Stairway to Heaven?"
Oh man.
Then I will thoroughly be impressed.
Is that the first question? Maybe. Why don't you answer? Who actually wrote Stairway to Heaven?
Well, apparently it was not Led Zeppelin because apparently. They got sued over it about 40 years later.
Okay. So then who was it?
I don't remember.
Oh man. Well, there you go. Should that be the first question?
You need the Blair, you need the Price is Right music that goes bum bum ba bum bum.
Yeah. The fail.
Yeah, the epic fail music.
Or. There you go.
Yeah, there you go. Fail.
Okay, how about this?
Excuse me while I kiss the sky.
So who actually wrote that then? Or is that a tricky?
That would be Jimi Hendrix off the album Are You Experienced from 1967.
All right, let's move on now. Let's move on. Now that we got past that, let's see. Let's head over. Let's do some news, Jimmy. Want to do some news?
Let's do some news. News from around the launch.
News from around the launch. Let's start with something that I've been, and I'll let you go off on it for a little bit.
Yeah.
The whole... Bassmaster Classic, which was how many weeks ago? Three weeks ago.
Was yeah, it really? I believe so.
Okay. Bassmaster Classic, throwing the, was it a striper?
Yeah, the old fish thrower.
He was throwing and caught on camera, let's add. Let's just make sure that everybody's aware of that. If you
yes,
have not
it's all
heard
over
this.
The new, it's all yeah. over the fishing interwebs, Bassmaster.com, Twitter, Facebook. So, I've seen that picture probably 1,000 times in 3 weeks.
And social media has been rampant, which that leads me to want to talk about this. Jimmy, what is your actual feeling of this whole throwing the fish back, not releasing it, throwing?
Right. I've got 2 points on this, and I'll explain myself. First point, obvious. It's not cool.
Right.
That's not anything to do, especially on that level. You know, you're supposed to be the poster child of, you know, conservation and... You know, respect for not only the fishery, but your competitors and the fish themselves. And
so we're saying disrespect to the sport, correct?
It's hard to say fully disrespect to the sport.
But isn't the sport including these lovely fish that we attempt to catch each and every
week.
Yes,
it is. It is, for sure. However, that much money on the line, he's chasing green.
Understandable.
Meaning he's chasing green fish. And I will give you a perfect example of this used to happen to me all the time. Okay, fishing tournaments on Lake Mead in Las Vegas, okay, out in Nevada, and it would happen on some of the lakes in California. You'd go out on a day chasing smallies and greenfish and catch 100 tuxedo fish. And so it would get kind of frustrating to the point of like, oh man. And I'll be honest, I've chucked a couple stripers before. Like in the heat of the moment, will you please get out of here kind of thing. I mean, I didn't chuck them like, you know, over my head, but you know, you're not releasing them nicely.
Right. Right.
Cause I mean, you're in a tournament. I'm fishing. You know, and it's not excusable. I'm just saying in the heat of that moment, you know, I'm chasing greenfish and I'd catch all, you know, we called them tuxedo fish. But then I'd go out actually striper fishing and wouldn't catch anything.
Now, I'm not saying, I mean, you didn't have all these cameramen and photographers following you. You're not supposed to do it at any time. And like you said, it was the heat of the moment. But him knowing that he has this much media surrounding him and eyes watching him, right. Don't you think that...
Oh, it's a bad call on his part,
okay.
For sure.
Okay.
Now, and I'm not disagreeing with that. However... You know, and like I said, I'm not defending the guy. I've just got two different points where I can.
Has he won?
Almost point counterpoint with myself.
What's his? What do you off the top of your head know his? I mean, what has he won, or which has he won any major tournaments?
He hasn't won any majors. However, you know, he's a good stick, and he has won some. I believe he won an Elite Series last year, and he placed up in the top enough to qualify for the Classic.
Now,
so
did he fish FLW before, or am I thinking of somebody else?
I'm trying to think came up from. I don't remember him much in FLW. If he was there, he wasn't a big player. He's not one of the crossover guys.
Still, he's been around. He's been around for quite a while.
He's been around for a while, and he's a Tennessee guy. So, I mean, anything around Tennessee or on a river impound, you know, putting him on a fantasy fishing thing or something would just be not smart if you didn't put him on there because he's that good. He's very consistent. I mean, the guy is, for as young as he is, you know, he's a good stick. Here's my other point real quick. Okay, so here I am in the Bassmaster Classic. It's day two. I'm fishing for $500,000, or $250,000, whatever first place is.
Right.
I'm fishing for not only that, but just the notoriety of you're the Bassmaster Classic champion for 2015. And I'm in contention. I'm catching these fish. You're sitting there just slow grinding a jig, or you're throwing that underspin that those guys were throwing, and wham, rod loads up, right? Set the hook. Man, adrenaline's going and everything. Yeah, man, this is a big fish. And then you get it where you can see it, and it's like a 7-pound striper. That would absolutely break my heart.
Right. Just working. My personal opinion is this is wrong on all levels. I mean, we get on athletes' cases all the time, whether it be the NFL, NBA, you know, whatever, when they start acting like idiots. I personally think from the pictures, now he's heaving this thing like it's a salmon in the Seattle, that Seattle fish market I mean, is he not? I mean, he is like under tossing the thing up in the air.
Right.
What's the fish market called?
Oh, isn't that the flying fish? Seattle Fish Market? I don't know, dude. I've never been there.
But anyways, he's throwing this thing as if it was a last second shot, you know, to win the game. To win the game.
Half court.
Yeah, half court. Here's the striper shot. Oh, just bounces off. But yeah, just wrong on all levels. I mean, I see, you know, I understand what you're saying.
Right.
And that seems to be the case with everybody else.
But like I said, I'm not defending him. I just know, yes, he made a mistake, but in the heat of the moment, it's really easy for people to make that mistake.
Right.
And, you know, it's one of those things that if you've had that happen before, you can kind of understand where he's going, where he's coming from. But like I said, I'm not gonna say it's okay, because it's not.
Now, this will lead into our next little topic. Did he have any sponsors that actually dropped him or shunned him, however that works?
You know, I didn't see.
Because I know people
I didn't see anything on that, and it's kind of like the second incident with these fishermen this year, and I don't know what's going on in the fishing world, but it's kind of crazy.
Yeah, it seems this year, and like I said, this leads us into our next topic, sponsorship towards amateurs, such as yourself, myself, and probably 99.9456% of the people that will be listening to this. But it seems the world or the fishing industry has taken a negative turn. I don't know if it's really fully negative or if people have gotten lazy or if people have gotten accustomed or selfish. I mean, what would you say the world of sponsorship has become from your vantage point?
Oh, well,
I mean, look at it both ways. I mean, we won't mention full companies, but we have both been on either side of the ball, you know, in this case, as a business owner and now as a amateur, you know, tournament angler. So go ahead. I mean, what do you think has happened to this fishing industry come sponsorships?
Here's one point I have on it. And I'm not knocking it, but I think there's too many companies out there.
Just too many companies in general, or maybe too many of these small companies.
There's a lot of small companies out there. I had one of them, you know? So and so I know plenty of guys that still own these small fishing companies. And we would get asked all the time, can I do this? Can I do this? Have this? Throw your baits.
Right.
And I'm like, well, who are you?
Right.
And not saying it as being a jerk, but like I'm looking on his Facebook page and he's caught like taking pictures of 3 or 4 fish in a year. There's no tournaments going, you know what I mean? There's just nothing. And I'm like, you want my stuff for free?
Right.
Because I work hard for that stuff.
So on the business side, was your first question ever, which product do you like best? Or which bait do you like best? Was that ever your first question to try and, I don't know, maybe make them feel like a dumbass? Yeah. Because...
I would go, well, what have you thrown? Or have you thrown any of my stuff?
I demand satisfaction.
Right. I demand satisfaction. have you thrown my stuff? Have you have you been a loyal customer of mine? Because I don't remember you. I'm small enough at this point. I look at all the PayPal invoices myself, and your name or address has never come up.
Right. That's a good point. Always looking
and
back.
Your mom never ordered a gift card from me. Yeah. I have no idea who you are. So from that standpoint, with the sponsors, I can understand how these smaller companies can get kind of fed up with that, because there's a lot of people just looking for handouts.
Right. Right.
They don't want to help promote.
They just want that logo on the jersey to fill up the jersey a little bit better.
Right. Right. Now, also, on the other hand, remember, a pro staffer does not stand for professional.
Now, there's where the gray area comes into play, because the technical definition, you know, if you get paid just like, I don't know what the best sport, but if you get paid.
Yeah, like KVD. Go ahead.
If you get paid to do something or get any kind of gifts in return to do something, that technically makes you a professional by definition. Let's keep that in mind.
Correct. You are, if I fish for a living and I claim on my taxes that I am self-employed due to my fishing, then I am a professional. However, with my companies, I am not a professional. When they call me a pro staffer, I am a promotional staffer.
Oh, I see what you did there. I see what you did.
Haha, see that? You see that little twisty twist? And that's the way most companies are looking at it. What have you won? What have you done? And what can you do for me? The fishing industry is no longer what can we do for you. It's what can you do for us? Because we're doing fine without you.
So,
and I think that's their attitude. The bigger companies, I would say that's kind of, and it's not all of them. You know, there's still a lot of big name companies out there that are very grassroots and are very approachable,
right,
and are okay with people, you know, doing things. And then there's some big companies out there that have on their website, do not contact us about pro staff opportunities.
Right, right. Well, I mean, because they get inundated by however
they get
many,
flooded every day. Just people, hey, I like Zoom. Let me throw a Zoom.
Right, right.
Dude, buy Zoom.
And I mean, we're gonna flip the coin now. But
right,
there was something that you sent me earlier this week. I won't name the, even though it's out there all over the place, I'm just gonna read it. It's from a social media. I believe this is from a social media outlet, right? The one with
that was on the twit.
Okay, so I'm gonna read this, and everybody will probably might get it from the name I'm gonna mention. But here's how it goes: Matthew, they are not even on the market, and less than 100 are being used by fishermen across the country. For argument's sake, if it's good enough for Aaron Martin's, it's good enough for anyone else at a lower level of competition. Now, the person that this was going back and forth to, they kind of responded with the good old LOL. I'd imagine the sponsorship agreement had more to do with it than the quality of the product. Thanks for the reply. That made the decision of the lower level angler much easier.
Right.
Now, that's that sums it up. I mean, so do you think that this was maybe a company that, I mean, I'm not trying to take sides, but they said there's probably less than 100 using this product. So
yeah, it's a newer rod company. We don't have to drop names, but right, they're a newer rod company out there.
Right. So do you think that maybe they've gotten inundated and this, you know, they accidentally, out of anger, maybe this person was bugging them for a sponsor, you know, something like that. Do you think out of anger they dropped that lower level of competition term?
You know, I don't really think so. I think they were more or less like, I think they've turned smarmy. you know, and that's like one of my favorite words.
That's a new one. Can you give us the definition, please?
Smarmy. Can you
use it in a sentence, please?
Yeah, the guy at the coffee shop was getting all smarmy. It's like a better than you attitude. Kind of pompous, okay, and smart, okay, ass at the same time.
All right. I'll
take it. So you're smarmy?
I'll take it.
Okay. They were I feel like they were getting really smarmy because they have Aaron Martin's throwing this, you know, he's using this new rod and he thinks it's great.
So, just too big for their britches.
Right. And who knows if he really, I mean, I'm sure he really enjoys the product, but I really enjoy free stuff too.
Right, right. Well, everybody.
Oh, did I say that out loud?
Yeah.
Oh, scared.
Yeah. Probably shouldn't. No.
So, and I've had the same thing. I just had that happen to me.
Right. So, yeah, that's bringing me to this. So now let's flip the coin, because this week has been interesting, I would say, to the both of us. And again, we're not going to drop any type of names or do anything like that. But the incidences that we had this week from a tournament angler perspective has also gave us some lemon heads taste in our mouth.
Right.
Yeah.
Completely. Yeah. I'll go ahead and share mine first. One week before, I'd say maybe 10 days before the Classic, so a month and a half ago, I had approached a company, told them everything that was going on.
Have you used this product before? Let's go through the motions, just to be fair. Have you used the product before? Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And you liked it?
Yes.
It works for you?
Yes.
Has worked for you?
Yes.
Okay. Go on.
So use the product, like it, think it's innovative, and it could be a game changer. Contact the company. Company sends me back an email because I sent them a very polite email. Hey, this is me. This is what I'm doing. This is my schedule.
Now, do you have a generic? I've seen these, and I've learned about them. I've heard about them. Do you have a template that all you do is fill in the blanks, if you will?
No, I kind of type. I make my fishing resume when I approach companies who need a resume or who just give me their email.
Right.
I kind of just hand type a resume of who I am, where I came from, what I'm doing now, and what tournaments I have fished, okay, and what tournament series I'm currently fishing.
Okay.
And then anything else I do, you know, I record myself fishing on YouTube and stuff, and I make my own little YouTube fishing show. So, hey, I do that. I'm fishing with the, you know, blah, blah, blee, blee, you know, blah, blah, blah.
Okay,
so I send them the email. He gets back with me. James, I'd love to hear from you. Give me a call tomorrow morning when you get this sometime after 8. Okay, great. Give him a call. Man, it sounds like this is going to be great. This is going to work out. I'll tell you what I'll do. Make me up a list of the stuff you want. I'll send it to you for cost. If you resell it to your friends or whatever, you can sell it for retail. So almost not only being pro staff with the company, but almost being like
a distributor. A distributor,
right. A distributor and a staff position. And I was thinking, yeah, this is great.
Mm-hmm.
Make them up an email. Send it back 3 or 4 days later, chirp, chirp. That's the sound of crickets.
Oh.
when I say chirp, chirp.
Oh, okay. That was, sorry.
You're like, what?
I didn't know what that was.
Yeah.
I didn't know what that one was supposed to be.
Yeah, that's what that was.
Okay.
So I don't hear anything back. I,
I didn't know if I the chirp chirp was, you know, they said chirp chirp, or that was a tweet or something, maybe.
That's, what?
I thought maybe that was a tweet. You meant like they tweeted you, chirp chirp, tweet. No, no.
No.
No. Is this thing on? Okay.
Hello.
Hello. Hello, McFly.
Hello. Oh, Gleben. So I see on face twat page, you know, whatever, that they're heading to the Classic. They're going to get a booth at the expo. Now it's like, okay, so they're really busy this week. I'll give them some time. So I wait till for a couple days after the Classic. I call them in the afternoon. Hey, how's it going? How was the Classic? Oh, things are great. Can I call you back later this evening? Okay, sure. Later this evening. Chirp, chirp.
Time goes by.
The next day. Yeah, the next day. Chirp, chirp. It's like SpongeBob now. It's like 4 hours later. Yeah. You know, I'm like waiting and waiting and waiting and hearing nothing. I call again, voicemail. I email again, voicemail. So apparently I've been kicked off of the team before, man. I even got on the team.
That's bad.
And now I've officially thrown their product in the bin that I just took down to my friend for his yard sale.
So do you want to maybe promote the yard sale so these people can go pick up the product?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The Cossey residents in Prairie Grove, Arkansas are having a bake sale and a yard sale Saturday and Sunday.
Please stop on by and
get Prairie Grove. There's like five people there and everybody knows everybody in Prairie Grove, so it's not hard to find.
Prairie Grove.
Prairie Grove.
Prairie Grove. Okay. Wow.
So why don't you tell us?
We're
ranting. Let's talk about you.
Yeah, we're on this subject. We're going real long on this subject. There's one, and I don't know how. I mean, because the both of us, this happened to both of us, just this past week, with the same company that I've been a part of for, I don't know, what would you say, a year?
A year, yeah.
Yeah, a year now. Just getting going again. Let's see. I was planning on heavy hitting tournaments coming up this month, actually, at the end of this month. Got my product all squared away with this. Do you want to say manufacturer?
Yes.
I mean, manufacturer. To my specs, I'm expecting stuff. I'd say a month goes by when I was expecting my first care package of product. And I had to get you involved because you were a bigger proponent of this company. And I was coming to the great, what do you want to be called? The know-it master of getting lighting fire under people's asses. Is that good?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, that's good.
Went to you. You helped me out. We were going back and forth. You were acting as the middleman, and I appreciate every minute that you helped. And then it just seemed like you called the other day to help me once again light a fire under somebody's ass, and the bottom just fell out. Is the best way I could probably say that, right? I mean, yeah. You had, I guess, the end result, which ultimately have now led us to absolutely
nothing.
Well,
let's fast forward a couple days. I'm actually, me and this manufacturer are actually okay again.
Now you're okay again.
But that still doesn't resolve your issue.
Well, now this is news to me. Well, now, isn't that...
Okay, here's, Yeah, ready?
Isn't that something?
Can we edit this out? Beep, 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 beep. Let's edit this out.
But, I'm back in business, baby!
Yeah, I'm back in business, baby. Yeah, I'm okay with him. He's okay with me. However, he's decided that just because of him trying to get everything situated,
right,
that he's not even going to have pro staff this season.
So, I mean, that's still that drops the ball on people that are expecting and have put stuff in the plans, which is kind of a crap hole.
No, correct. Right. And he understands that completely.
Right.
You know, but it's just one of those things, man. You know, he started this up late last year and then had some, you know, issues getting it started this year with licensing and other things, and I'm not making excuses, but you know, going from one state to another with it was just a whole new set of problems. So
right.
He's okay, everything's good, and he's ready to get things rolling. However, he just doesn't feel like he can take the role of pro staff on this year while doing this. So apparently now I'm in charge when he does fire back up pro staffing. I will be in charge of all the interviewing of pro staffers.
And interviewing. Yes. Huh. Well, all right.
Huh. New pro staffers.
Well, yeah, and obviously you're gonna have to find some new pro staffers since people have been left hanging and now left out to dry. But
yes.
Interesting. Okay, yes. Let's move on then, because that's a brand new. See, that makes for good radio. Good.
Yeah, the hosts podcasting. Actually despise one another, ladies and gentlemen. At this very moment, he's like, "Oh, wow. You some bitch."
This is brand new news to me.
Brand new news. Yeah.
Let's see. We are running that whole segment took quite a long time. Do you want to talk about this, the weirdest thing you've caught, or do you want to save that for next week?
Save that for next week, because we kind of ran over with Doc Talk this week.
And that's to keep in mind,
I can talk about the weirdest thing you've ever caught for a half hour rant.
Yeah,
so
we'll talk about that. This numero uno show, Rockin the Cast, is brought to you by the Custom Bait Company. Custom Bait Company wants to know, can you jig it, brother? Oh, we were having who said that? Are we saying Macho Man was originally, can you dig it? Are we saying that he was the originator of that?
No.
Who? Who is?
The guy from the Warriors movie.
Warriors, come out and play.
Yeah, the dude at the end, and he's like, you know, getting the gangs all together to fight, and he's like, can you dig it? Can you dig it?
Oh, okay. Yeah,
can you dig it?
Now I know what you're talking about. Well, the Custom Bait Company wants to know, can you jig it?
Yes.
With over 30 years of hand-pouring jigs, the difference is in the pigs they catch. The Custom Bait Company offers shake it, football heads, and swim jigs that are all handmade and double painted to provide durability no matter how hard you fish them. Worried about a stout hook when throwing into the grass? Well, no worries with the Custom Bait Company, as they build all their jigs with trusted Mustad hooks. Don't think they have a color combo that you can use or that you'll like? Think again. The Custom Bait Company offers 46 different color combos. Ready to fish the difference? Visit CustomBaitCo.com for your difference maker today.
Yes.
And Jimmy, I know you're going to be throwing these soon.
Very soon.
We will
very
be
soon.
Having, I'm sure, a tackle talk and tackle review on those coming up. Maybe, what, will you say next week?
Yeah. I will have I'm actually going to be throwing them in the tournament Sunday.
Okay.
They should be here. I've got a couple custom, the only company I've seen that makes them, they're called the DSJ. aka Drop Shot Jig. Instead of tying on a circle hook, you tie on this jig and then you run down to your weight. Game changer, bro.
So yeah, we'll have to talk about those coming up.
Yeah, I would like to say though, real quick, that I did get a hold of Shane this week, and instead of doing the Wildy attack, I'd like to go ahead and take a minute, if I could, and talk about Shane's fishing team.
Okay, let's do that. Since we're
kind of coming off of a negative sponsorship deal. So, Shane's fishing team.
That's what that was.
So, Shane's fishing team over at custombaitco.com. He has an application online. Whether you've fished jigs, whether you're brand new, whether you've never thrown a bait in your life or thrown his product, you can apply for Custom Bait Co.'s fishing team. He started that in January of 13, and he felt like the big companies had forgotten where they came from.
So what's the difference? What makes Custom Bait Co. Different than these other jig companies that are out there? Bait companies. The team.
Right. With the fishing team now, okay, he also felt like the fishing industry wasn't looking out for the everyday guy. The 99%ers, you know, the guy who works 50 hours a week, goes into the tackle store and buys stuff, to make a fishing trip happen. Or he's got a little weekend jackpot tournament or a Wednesday night jackpot, you know. The guys who basically make the fishing industry what it is. So what he decided to do was start this company. Start the fishing team that he had the company established already. He wanted to do this with a no obligation to the person. All you have to do is pay for the startup kit. It's $30. You get to pick $25 worth of merchandise, and he gives you you get a team sticker and some other stuff if he says that, you know, you're a good fit for the team. And then you can test the product, then you can throw his stuff with the $25 of product you get and really give, you know, it a good shot. But there's no commitment as far as I have to go to this tackle store and promote, or I have to sell X amount of product in order for me to stay with the team. There's nothing like that. He feels like, and this is, you know, quoted from him, he feels like pro staffers now are turning into more or less salesmen.
Right.
And they're actually pushing product for the companies when the people who work at the companies should be pushing their product. And the fishermen should be out talking to other fishermen about the product.
Right.
So it's a new versus old school approach. Back when these companies were first starting to really do this tournament thing, you know, and really found that, you know, hey, this guy winning this tournament on this bait could help sell this bait. They had fishing teams. You know, Zoom had a fishing team. Man's Bait Company had one of like the best fishing teams out there. Right. And it was just a group of guys who talked to each other about fishing, who could share things about what's going on with them and the bait company, get some feedback, and everything would go. Mm. And he's trying to just bring that back. We've got members from all over the United States on our team, including Canada. So if you're going to a trip to Texas, you might put it on the fishing team's Facebook page, hey, I'm going down to Texas. One of the guys down there says, hey, I don't live far from where you're staying. Boom, you've got a fishing buddy.
Ah, I see.
You know, so it's a really, a good way to stay linked in, and you never have to push product. A word to any social media about Custom Bait Company, but Shane promises that you will because his product's that good.
Wow. Okay.
So that's
interesting concept.
Yeah, I think it's great, much, man. It's and way and different. I'm really excited about this year. I've been completely since becoming a member just last week of the fishing team. You know, I've been welcomed by a lot of people on the fishing team. Hey, welcome to the team. Blah blah blah. It's been pretty cool, man.
So, I mean, the question is floating out there. How much product do you get for the $25? Does it actually, are you getting a decent amount of product to try, or?
Well, yeah, it's basically whatever the price is listed online.
Okay.
You will get a discount being a team member, but the first $25 is just retail for the product. Right. And his product's reasonable. Like a 3/4 football head, I believe, is $375 on the website.
$375 on the website on custombaitco.com.
Right. So you can, what's $375, man, times?
I don't know.
That's like eight. That's like eight football head jigs.
Are you sure?
Seven. With
Are you sure?
Seven with the 75 cents.
Do I have to bring up the count?
Are you testing my math skills?
Let's see. 375 times
7.
26.25, you're over.
Okay, so you'd pay the additional $1.25.
You're over. That is wrong. So
womp, 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 womp.
So, oh man. So we're looking at how many jigs then? Six. Six.
Okay, so six jigs.
Six jigs. Okay.
But that's still good.
That is good. That's outstanding.
Especially for a handmade custom jig
with the mustad hooks.
With the mustad hooks and double paint. So if you hit a rock, you're all of a sudden you're not just shiny.
Oh yeah. Yeah, exactly. Oh, we all know that feeling.
Yeah, hit one rock, and all of a sudden you're taking the Sharpie out, and you're recoloring your lead.
All right. Let's. Do you want to go into Kayak Corner and talk about this real quick?
Kayak Corner. What were we going to talk about?
We were going to talk about the wild the attack.
I already said we'd save that for next week. Do you not listen to your host?
Attack. Okay. We're going to save that. Let's go down to, let's open the door for other businesses and show sponsors. You can always contact us by emailing us at rockinthecast@gmail.com. You could get a hold of us on Twitter, and we will get back to you fairly quick to talk to you about sponsorship opportunities for our show here. And I was going to say in the great state of Georgia, but we're not both in Georgia.
Not yeah, peaches and hogs, dude. Peaches and hogs.
Yeah, peaches and hogs. That sounds wrong.
That sounds like a movie. Ding, 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 ding.
Deliverance. Oh, great.
The southern guys will know what I'm talking about.
All right. Before we do have some Jimmy's words, we have some Yankee. Jimmy's words of wisdom's coming up. What do you have going on? I know you already said that you have a tournament coming up Sunday.
Yeah. Arkansas Kayak Anglers up here in the Northwest Division, the Razor Yak Tournament Trail. Our first tournament is this Sunday on Swebco Lake in Gentry, Arkansas.
Gentry Lake.
That's our hot lake.
What... Yeah, I had a question. There was a question there. All right. We're going to skip that question. And get ready. Are you ready, Jimmy?
Yeah.
Are you ready? For. Yeah.
For what?
Jimmy's words of wisdom. This week, Jimmy will give us his words of wisdom. Jimmy, are you ready for your words of wisdom?
Yes. That was epic, dude. I'm like ready to start pulling my shoes off, and it's a beautiful day in the neighborhood.
That was the whole plan. All right, give us your Jimmy's words of wisdom.
Okay, Jimmy's words of wisdom this week. It's really simple, guys and gals and people out there in interwebs land.
Yes.
Be the bait.
Be the bait. Jimmy.
Be the bait. Yes, and I will explain for just a second, because there is a lot to discuss on this topic, but it's just words of wisdom and not an entire speech of wisdom.
Jimmy's words of wisdom.
Yeah. So, being the bait, thinking instead of, a lot of guys are notorious for this, I couldn't catch him on a frog. Okay? You couldn't catch him on a frog. So you decided not to pick up a weightless stick bait,
right,
or a fluke, or, you know, go to a different place on the lake. They get so hung up on force feeding, trying to force feed fish to do what they want to do, that they're not thinking like the bait.
Right. And I don't want to say, I mean, my 10-year-old who is an outstanding, and you know, my 10-year-old who is an outstanding angler, I mean, the kid can outfish me any day, but that is his mentality on a lot of days where
yeah,
it's that he's not the bait, I guess is what you're saying.
Right. And it goes into some in-depth crazy stuff, man, I've been watching. But, you know, throwing baits uphill instead of downhill, sideways instead of from shallow to deep. Being what would a gizzard shad or what would a crawdad or what would a bluegill look like if he was over here? And fishing that way versus, well, I cranked until my arm fell off and I couldn't catch a fish.
And that probably goes because somebody told them, oh, what's that crank that, what's his name's throwing all the time from Livingston there? He won the Classic last year.
Yeah.
And now he was just, I believe he was just throwing the dang thing again at up there in South Carolina.
Yeah.
What's his name? Him. Randy Howell.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. It just so happened that those fish went a little deeper and he had a little deeper running crankbait.
Right.
You know, it just so happened that Casey Ashley had his dad's underspin, or the old school guys call them pony heads, with a fluke on it and was slow rolling it on the bottom along with a scrape and a mop jig. And now you can't even find underspins. Right. And there's guys selling them now on eBay for $11.99. but you know, that might not work. The next day they go out to throw that. Oh man, he won the Classic on it, and they start grinding it in the bottom. Well, what if those fish are suspended and looking up? You know, if they're chasing two inch shad and you're throwing a jig crawdad color, you know, are you think you're gonna get bit that much?
Right.
Be the bait, brother. Be the bait.
So Jimmy's words of wisdom for this week. Be the bait.
No.
And that was Jimmy's words of wisdom.
Jimmy's words of wisdom. Jimmy's words of wisdom. Jimmy's words of wisdom.
Oh, there you go. We should override this and turn it into your ending of Jimmy's words of wisdom.
Yes. Jimmy's words of wisdom about you.
It's all about the fishing. There you go. All right. That's enough of that.
Nice.
All right. We have run extra late on this first show of Rock in the Cast. Is there anything that you want to close with that we should probably hit real quick before we take off and head to next week's show? So we've missed. Let's see. You're going to talk about the Wilderness Systems attack. They shouldn't have a cool attack. You know, like a cool little attack. Weirdest thing that you've ever caught. We'll talk about that. Yeah. We should probably open that to listeners too. Give us some feedback on the weirdest thing you've ever caught.
Yeah, Twitter, Facebook, email us the weirdest thing you've ever caught, and we may talk about it on the show, or at least throw it a bone.
Yeah, throw it a bone. Throw it a bone. So yeah, let's see. What else do we have?
What else coming up? Oh, I'll be talking about the Sunday tournament.
Oh, yes. Are you doing, I know we talked about this, are you doing an interview for us? Are you going to attempt to?
Yeah, I will attempt to interview the winner or any of the sponsors that may show up.
Okay.
To talk about their product. I could do some stuff like that. And hopefully play it on the feed.
Yes. We could also post it on thepodcastblock.com where this show can be heard. But like I said, we will also be heard on, what are we going to be heard on? The SoundCloud.com.
Yes.
BlogTalkRadio.com and iTunes. And then we will soon have our YouTube channel in full gear.
Yes.
And we will also keep everybody abreast of all this. Abreast. Do you like that? Abreast. On Twitter.
Big words.
On Twitter. At Rockin' the Cast. So make sure you get all that in. Let's see. What else do we have? Is that it?
That's it, man. Big shout out to Shane, CustomBaitCo.com.
And that looks like it, my friends.
That's the show, buddy.
I think we are done for the week. We have actually just completed the first Rockin' the Cast show.
Episode 1.
Maybe next week you could do the robot voice.
Episode 2.
The robot voice in the beginning.
Everybody listen to episode 2 next week. It's going to be a very great show. I'm no longer in California. I've moved to Arkansas. So listen to Blair and Jimmy on Rockin' the Cast, you assholes.
All right, everybody. We will catch you next week on Rockin' the Cast.
Shake for a shake. I'm throwing these Emirates in the sky. Spinning this awesome llama. Make them piece the M-O-N-E-Y. I love my beaches.